biology.
So very much welcome there to this class whereby today I want us to discuss about classification 2. In form 1 we did classification 1, now we are going to look at classification 2. So what did we say classification is? We define classification as the grouping of organisms and placing them into correct groups of ancestry and behavioral characteristics and adaptations. So what are the principles used in classifying organisms? So the first principle used in classifying organisms, we have the anatomical structure. Now for the anatomical structure, we see that this mainly considers the internal structures of different organisms. Then the next one, we have the embryonic development, which mainly considers the development of the embryo from the process of fertilization up to the later developments of the organism. Then the next one, we have the physiological processes, which mainly considers the different functions of the different body parts of the organism. Also, let's remind ourselves what binomial nomenclature is. So what did we say binomial nomenclature is in Form 1? We define binomial nomenclature as the scientific double naming system of living organisms, whereby the organism is given a genus name and a species name. Now, in writing the scientific name on the rules of binomial nomenclature, we say that they must apply. Also, reminding ourselves, we say that we have 7 taxonomic units of classification, whereby the first one, we say that it was kingdom, then phylum or division, then after that we have class, family, genus, and then finally we had species. Now, considering the kingdom, we saw that we had 5 kingdoms of classification, whereby the first one is kingdom Monera, comprising of only the bacteria. So the other name of kingdom Monera, we say that it is kingdom Prokaryota. Then apart from that, we have the next kingdom, which is kingdom Protoctista or kingdom Protista or kingdom Eukaryota. So the organisms under this kingdom, we say that we have protozoa, we have algae, and then finally we have the amoeba. So the next kingdom that we looked at kingdom fungi or kingdom mycophyta. So the next kingdom is kingdom plantae, comprising of all the plants, and kingdom animalia, comprising of all the animals. Now let's look at the first kingdom, which is kingdom Monera or kingdom Prokaryota. So what are the general characteristics? And remember, I've said general characteristic. The general characteristic means that they may share these characteristics with other organisms. So the first one is that these organisms are unicellular. Also, we see that they have a cell membrane and a cell wall, which is mainly made up of the murine enzyme. So the murine enzyme makes up their cell membrane and the cell wall. So the other characteristic is that these cells are prokaryotic cells, meaning that their nucleus are not membrane bound, or their nucleus does not have any nuclear membrane in them. So for the organelles in this organism, also they don't have a membrane, which mainly means that these cells are prokaryotic cells. So the word prokaryota originates from prokaryotic cells, meaning that they don't have membranes in the organelle. And then for the reproduction of this organism, we see that it reproduces asexually. So most of these organisms move by flagella means. So some of these organisms as well are autotrophs, while others are heterotrophs. Remember, in Form 1 nutrition topic, we say that autotrophs mean that they make their own food, organisms which make their own food. While heterotrophs, we say that these are organisms which depend on ready-made food from the environment. Then the other characteristic, we say that these organisms respire anaerobically. If you can remember, in the topic of respiration, we went through 2 types of respiration, whereby the first one we said was aerobic respiration. Now, in aerobic respiration, we say that these organisms must use oxygen for respiration to take place. The next one we say that it was anaerobic respiration, whereby the organisms, they don't require oxygen for respiration process to take place. Now, for the bacteria, they respire anaerobically, meaning that they don't require oxygen for the process of respiration. So the next characteristic is that they have a slimy outer cover over the cell wall, which is called the capsule, and is mainly made up of the mucin enzyme. Now, what are the distinguishing characteristics of these organisms? Because we have just gone through the general characteristics. Now let's look at this, the distinguishing characteristics, or the peculiar characteristics, which are only found in these organisms in Kingdom Monera and not in other organisms. So the first distinguishing characteristic is that these are prokaryotic cells, meaning that the nucleus is not bound in a nuclear membrane. The nucleus floats freely in the cytoplasm. So also, looking at the cell wall, we see that the cell wall is made up of murine enzyme, whereby it is only the cell of this organism which is made up of murine enzyme or peptidoglycan enzyme, or rather peptidoglycan material. So the other characteristic is that they have no membrane in the organelles. So all the organelles, they do not have a membrane. And then lastly, they have a capsule over the cell wall. Now, speaking about bacteria, let's now look at the structure of the bacteria. And as you can see on the diagram, the bacteria is a very simple structure. Now, on the diagram, we can see that there is the ribosome. And in form one, we discussed the function of the ribosome. We say that it is protein synthesis. So protein synthesis means that it makes protein. So the function of the ribosome also inside the bacteria is to make proteins for the bacteria. And also we see that there is the cytoplasm, whereby all the organelles may be found floating inside the cytoplasm. Also for the structure, you can see a cell membrane and you can also see a cell wall. We can also see a very powerful flagellum for this organism. The function of the flagellum is movement. So the flagellum facilitates movement for this organism. Also, we can see a plasmid, which is a circular DNA for this structure. And then finally, we can see the capsule over the cell wall. So what are the significances of bacteria? So the first significance of bacteria is decomposition. So for this decomposition, we see that it leads to the recycling of nutrients in ecosystem. And that's why bacteria are mostly important, because after a food has gone bad, the bacteria will decompose the food and then it will go back into the ecosystem, maybe to be eaten by other organisms. Also for the bacteria, the other significance is nitrogen fixing, whereby the rhizobium bacteria mainly fix nitrogen in the soil for other plants to consume. Also for the bacteria, we see that some bacteria manufacture vitamins, especially in the colon. So examples of the vitamin is vitamin K, which mainly facilitates bone development and regulation of calcium in the body. Also for the blood clotting process, you see that platelets are very much important for the blood clotting process, since they act as raw material for the same. Also the next mineral or the next vitamin is vitamin B12, which mainly keeps the nerves and the blood cells of the body healthy. So the other significance of bacteria is that it facilitates the industrial processing of food. Example, we have the yogurt, which it's mainly formed by the decomposition or the fermentation of milk to form yogurt. And then we also have the destruction of harmful materials in sewage, especially in water treatment plants. And also the other significance is that they're used in making silage and biogas for cooking. They also secrete cellulose, digesting cellulose, and also lignins, which digest lignin in the ruminants. And then lastly, the genetically engineered bacteria are used as a source of protein. Example, we have the production of insulin for the people suffering from diabetes mellitus. So what are the importances of bacteria? How are bacteria important in life? So first of all, they cause decay, hence food spoilage. So many diseases, example, we have the Streptococcus pneumoniae bacteria, which mainly causes the pneumonia disorder, and Vibrio cholerae, which mainly causes the cholera disorder. Also, you see that they also facilitate the denitrification process, hence reducing nitrogen from the atmosphere. Example, we have the Pseudomonas denitrificans bacteria. Now let's meet on the next class as we now look on the next kingdom, which is Kingdom Protoctista. Biology.